you're very welcome back. Now, my next guest's heart lies with researching brain health. Yes, her goal is to make information surrounding the brain accessible to everyone, and she wants to educate people about the misinformation surrounding things like dementia. She's just released her first book, 100 Days to a Younger Brain. Dr. Sabina Brennan, you are very welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for having
me. And I told you, I have been a bit of a fan of yours from afar because I've heard you speak. It's the way you speak about a topic that you wouldn't necessarily think would be as interesting as you make it. You make it sound like a very fascinating subject.
But it is fascinating. I mean, the brain is, oh, you know, it's...
but told it's you, like, I want to
George say, Clooney.
I wanted to say sexy subject, and I was afraid to, but you do make it sound like a sexy subject.
Thanks very much. But yeah, I think we see too much of these. You know, when you see the brain, you're usually seeing a dead brain, you know, that's been preserved in formaldehyde. And it's not the prettiest thing. It's definitely no George Clooney.
No.
But the real brain is like, vibrant. You've got 86 billion neurons in your brain cells, and trillions of connections, and they're constantly firing chemical and electrical signals to each other. Like, your brains are on fire here at the moment, and that's really exciting, and that's the kind of thing that really, it's kind of the final frontier of our body, isn't it? Mm-hmm.
It is fascinating, like our memory, how we think of things, how we plan things in our brain, like everything
who
coming
we
from
find
our brain.
Attractive, what's the difference between love and lust and all those kind of things all happen in the brain. You know, I laugh, I did something actually, I was just saying to you guys earlier, you know, talking about attraction, and we think of, this is going off topic a little, but we think of, you know, the nether regions as being our sex organs, but actually your brain is your sex organ because it releases all the neurotransmitters and the hormones involved in that.
Is that for men?
That's a serious question.
It is, because I thought that sometimes if guys can't do it, it's a neurological thing. It's not a physical thing.
But all of sex is neurological because you release hormones. All your communications. So you're releasing dopamine that gives you the reward, but actually oxytocin is also released after you make love, more so in women, because that then becomes the kind of more cuddly hormone, and that's when sort of lust kind of moves towards love and companionship. But it's all going on in your brain.
Wow. Now, your brain is very interesting in itself. You only went back to study, you starred in Fair City, you had an acting career, and then decided, no, I'm going back and I'm going to study a PhD on the brain.
You can only go back to university if you went to university in the first place. So I never went to university in the first place. I actually did my leaving when I was about 16 and went straight into working in an insurance company, actually. And then when I had my own kids, I said, no, I want to do something I'm passionate about. So I acted for a while. And the reason I acted is because I'm interested in human behaviour, why people do the things they do. So then, long story short, I did a degree in psychology, and then I got a scholarship to do a PhD in the Institute of Neuroscience in Trinity.
Wow.
And did that around the brain and how it changes with age and memory function. And actually, it was during that, having come from a regular background, like a non-academic background, I was passionate. I drove all the other students insane because I had ate all the, I'd read all the books before the term even started, you know. But what really jumped out at me in the Institute of Neuroscience, and there is amazing scientists there, and they're doing incredible work. But a lot of the time they're talking to other scientists about their work at niche conferences or in academic journals that you and I don't have access to. And actually, because they're behind paywalls, but even if you did have access to them, you wouldn't bloody understand it because it's a different language. Now, I enjoyed that as an undergrad, learning that language. And it was great to feel as someone who'd left school 20-odd years before, because I was terrified going to university because... and I would say that to anyone out there who is thinking about going to university older, go for it. There is no... Don't underestimate your life experience, all those things that you've got. You've dealt with mortgages, you've raised kids, you've held down jobs. All of those things give you an advantage over the younger kids who are coming straight in. So anyway, that's sidetracking there. But really what jumped out at me was that I started to read all this information about things that you can do to boost your brain health, things that you can do to reduce your risk of developing dementia, things that can help you have a better prognosis should you sustain a brain injury or a disease like multiple sclerosis in early life. And I just said, Everybody deserves to know
people
that
don't
information.
Know that. Absolutely. It's just a part of getting old. Yeah.
And it's not.
There are things you can. So what are those things that, I mean, I know there's a lot of them in your book.
They're in the book and that's fine. And do you know what? I've loads of free materials online on my website, you know, so the whole point here is about getting the information out there to people. So things that you can do to boost your brain health. People are often surprised at this because they often say to me things like, oh, I do Sudoku and I do crosswords. Getting physically active is one of the best things you can do for your brain health, because your brain only weighs 2% of your body, but it consumes 25% of the oxygen and nutrients you take in. So it needs a really, you know, good fit system and a good supply to function well. Challenging your brain is key. I often laugh, and I do talk about in my book, that we front load things that are really good for your brain health, like education and learning, into the early part of our life, and then we stop doing it, and we coast along. Now, there's this wonderful thing called neuroplasticity, which really just explains that our brain adapts and changes, and it's our experiences and the life choices that we make that shape our brain and change it at any age.
How come some people are really brainy though? Like, you look at those kids on television, you know, like, and they've got IQs of 150, 160. How come people use? There are some people that use their brain like Einstein, and then there's me.
Oh, no, no, but you see, the thing is, so this is, that's what I must say as well, this book is not a book about being brainy. It really isn't. This is a book about maximising your brain function and actually just looking after the organ itself.
Oh, right.
So some people, it's a bit of, you know, when it comes to something like that, IQ makes, you know, gives a list of what, you know, that you're good at IQ tests. And the thing is, those people might be good at that academic-y stuff. They could be absolutely crap at something else. You know, we're all good at something. Yeah. Mm. And there's different types of intelligence and everything. So that's not what it's about. It's about maximising how your brain functions and using it to your best potential, in a sense.
And can you undo any damage?
Yes. You can do under.
And is it ever too late to start?
So it's never too late to start looking after your brain health, and I will give a list of all the things that you can do before we finish. But when you hit about the age of 30, your brain starts to waste away and atrophy a bit. And we used to think there was nothing you can do about that. But now we know that if you live a brain healthy life, you can increase the connections within your brain and even increase the volume of your brain. And that not only helps to counteract the atrophy, but if you're fortunate enough to get a disease like Alzheimer's disease, you may even, so there's a distinction between Alzheimer's disease and the dementia that is the symptom of that. Right. So you can have the disease in your brain and not have the dementia symptoms.
Okay.
Now, it's more about how much healthy brain you have rather than how much disease or pathology you have in your brain. Now, it's not a get out of jail free card. There's no golden ticket. Over time, that dementia, but that Alzheimer's disease pathology, you'll have more of that and less healthy brain. But the good news is you'll have been able to hold on to your important functions and live independently for longer. So that's what's really important,
isn't it? And we'll keep your brain more challenged and healthy.
Yeah, so it's about pushing out the onset of symptoms.
So what are the things? Are the exercises, you said physical exercise.
So I'll go through a list because I talk far too much, so I'll give a list so I don't annoy everybody out there. Get physically active, challenge your brain. So that's learning new things. Doesn't have to be academic. If you learn a musical instrument, you know, if you play an instrument, learn something, a piece more complex, or play another instrument, whatever you love. Push yourself to the next level.
Is it try a new thing? If you took a yoga class,
new people, new things, new food, different radio station, different genre books, just something that your brain has to work hard on. Stay socially engaged. Just talking to people is challenging for your brain. It's quite a complex function. Yeah. And loneliness and social isolation in terms of being bad for your brain health are equivalent to smoking and obesity. So social isolation social engagement is really important.
Is there an effect on things now like social media? Because we're not engaging face-to-face. A lot of the time we're engaging through either text message or online. Does that cause any damage?
I think it's important not to look at that all as a blanket thing, because we use the internet in different ways. So if you have a child on the internet and they're using it to write stories or write a blog, you know, that's stimulating. Yeah. If you're using social media to go from online to offline, that's really good. Also for people who are isolated, it's a way that they can connect with families and people in other countries. True. So that's beneficial. So as with everything, it's like balance. What's good for your heart is good for your brain, because it services it. attitude is hugely important. Attitude to aging, people who have a positive attitude to aging live longer. Mm-hmm. But people who understand, who think that memory loss is a normal part of aging, perform more poorly on memory tests. So a positive attitude to aging is really important. We do need to start embracing aging. And with age, wisdom grows and our ability to make decisions and good judgments. It's not all about decline.
And we care less about the small stuff, don't we?
Yeah, you don't. And that's, managing stress is really important.
Is there any food that's good for the brain? I keep telling my kids to eat their salmon. And well, actually, am I lying to them?
No, actually, you're not lying to them. So generally what we say around brain health is a Mediterranean diet, so an all-over diet. But those oily fishes are really, yes, it's really good for brain health. And that's because of the omega-3 in those. Now, your brain needs certain nutrients, etc., but it's far better to get them from food rather than from supplements.
Okay, but try
watch
those
out for things like, so something like a deficiency in vitamin B12 can affect memory function, as can some medications. So if anyone's out there is worried about memory loss, don't jump to a conclusion that it's dementia. There's lots of other things that are treatable that it could be.
So okay, and help. You say you have a lot of stuff up on your website. It's sabinabrennan.ie. A lot of free information and help direct you elsewhere. And the book is called 100 Days to a Younger Brain. Dr. Sabina Brennan, thank you very much. Doesn't she make it sound sexy?
I feel brainier, yeah.
Yeah, there we go. Thank you very, very much for coming in. Now, it's time for another quick break, but when we come back, our one and only agony aunt is in the building. Tina Kumarianis is up next. See you for that in three.